So let me begin by telling the story of this 35-year-old man whom you can see. His diabetes was diagnosed in early 2019. He weighed more than 80 kilos. He was on metformin. He underwent the lifestyle intervention program. 3 months later, the oral drugs were stopped, and in late 2020, his weight is 68.2. He continues to be in remission. Another case, 45-year-old lady, diagnosed 2019, 75 kilogram weight, was on metformin in February 2020. Her weight is 70.2, OHS stopped November 2020, still in remission. One more case, diagnosed in 2017, was on metformin with good food. There was not much change of weight, but however, still the OHS could be stopped with good food. 4 years of diabetes, on metformin, good food, OHS stopped. 12 years of diabetes on 40 units of insulin. Weight reduced from 93 to 85 with good food. Insulin was stopped. 2019 onset, multiple OHAs. After lifestyle program, now on metformin alone, and see there's a little weight reduction as well. 18 years of diabetes, 40 units of insulin and oral drugs. After lifestyle intervention, now just on metformin, where insulin and sulfonylureas have been stopped. So, ladies and gentlemen, reversing diabetes is a possibility, and in today's world, we definitely have to look into the how we are going to do about how we would go about and achieve that. So first of all, we need to know what remission means. A partial remission is when the HbA1c stays less than 6.5 for more than 1 year. A complete remission is when HbA1c is less than 6 for more than 1 year. And a prolonged remission is when A1C is less than 6% for 5 years or more. So, having understood the definitions of remission, we need to recollect that this was the famous trial in 2017, the DIRECT study, the Diabetes Remission Clinical Trial, which made a paradigm shift in the management of diabetes. They targeted to lose more than 15 kilogram weight in patients attending primary care. They randomized around 300 patients. Half of them received a low calorie diet of around 800 calories, and they reduced their weight. And the other half were put on the best medicines. And overall, in the dietary intervention group, there was a 46% remission of diabetes at 1 year. That means they did not require any medicines after 1 year. And if they had lost more than 15 kilo, it was 86% of them who did not require any drug. If they had lost more than 10 kilograms, 73% went into remission. And they concluded that type 2 diabetes is a complication of weight gain and excess body fat and not necessarily a permanent condition. But how long would it sustain? The DIRECT study was followed up for the next 2 years. And in 2019, they published their results when they saw that of the original 46% who went into remission, 36% still continued to be in remission. And even for those who did not achieve remission, there was a 50% reduction in use of diabetes medication. So that means one-third of all diabetes cases, that means we just saw that 36% did not require any drug. And there were patients with 1 to 6 years of duration of diabetes, pre-existing diabetes on multiple drugs, excluding insulin. And they did not require any drug after a good lifestyle intervention, exclusively focusing on food. And if they had lost more than 10 kilos, almost 64% did not require any drug. So they concluded that type 2 diabetes is not a lifelong condition and is reversible by weight loss. Not just diabetes, the blood pressure, serum lipids, quality of life, everything improved. So type 2 diabetes is mainly caused by excess yet reversible fat accumulation in liver and pancreas, says Roy Taylor, the pioneer in this field. In liver, the excess fat worsens hepatic responsiveness to insulin, leading to increased glucose production. In the pancreas, the beta cells fail due to the fat-induced metabolic stress. And removal of excess fat from liver and pancreas with substantial weight loss can normalize hepatic insulin responsiveness, and in the early years, produce beta cell recovery. So isn't that very good? Isn't that too good? So type 2 diabetes has long been regarded as inevitably progressive, requiring increased number of OHAs and eventually insulin. But it is now certain that the disease can be halted. And that is a very, very important message. Type 2 diabetes can be understood as a potentially reversible metabolic state precipitated by the single cause of chronic excess intra-organ fat. So that is the pathophysiology which we are trying to look at. Ideally, an Indian is supposed to have a waist circumference of less than 90 centimeter in men and less than 80 centimeter in women. And if your waist circumference is higher, it indicates that there is lipid accumulation in various organs like muscle, heart, liver, and pancreas. And when filled with fat, these organs fail. Liver exports too much glucose and VLDL. Muscle fails to oxidize glucose and fat. Pancreatic first phase insulin response is lost, and thus you have diabetes. The complications of diabetes are not reversible, but the early diabetes itself is reversible. So we shouldn't be waiting too long. We should be intervening quite early, both to ensure that diabetes doesn't worsen and diabetes is reversed and thus complications are prevented. Obesity, we know, is pro-inflammatory, pro-thrombotic, and pro-insulin resistant. And the central fat depots do secrete a lot of adipokines, leading on to hypertension, dyslipidemia, diabetes, thrombosis, atherosclerosis, inflammation, and so on. So the fat is not inert. It is producing all these adipokines and producing all the deleterious problems. But the silver lining is that with weight loss, all these things can be reversed, and reversing obesity can reverse diabetes. Not just diabetes. You see, it can reduce the risk of developing hypertension by around 66% and prevent heart attacks and strokes to around 60%. So it's very good. And you don't have to wait too long. Fasting plasma glucose actually normalizes within 7 days of a low-calorie diet. 30% decrease in hepatic fat in the first 7 days appear to be sufficient to take care of the insulin sensitivity. And in 8 weeks, the glucose-stimulated insulin secretion returns to normal, which means the pancreatic fat content falls over 8 weeks and beta cell function starts improving. So the message is clear. As told by Roy Taylor and Mike Lean, and widely publicized in UK especially, type 2 diabetes is not for life. This now is recognized by many world bodies. And here you can see the global report on diabetes by the World Health Organization stating the same thing, that reversal is a possibility. The study from Barbados, the Look Ahead trial, again saying that remission rate with intensive lifestyle measures were 3 to 6 times higher, the PREDIMED study, various analyses which right now point towards potential remission with dietary intervention, the group from Netherlands who reduced their medications or eliminated that completely. And we did that in our practice when we studied the first 50 patients who underwent our lifestyle intervention program. 86% of them had some weight loss, and in 72% of them, drugs could be either decreased or stopped in just 3 months' time. And we published that in the World Diabetes Congress. So diabetes remission is possible. But most of the standard of care doesn't speak about that. And the diabetes remission rate, if you just give the usual routine standard of care, is only 0.23%. So that raises a serious question. And the status quo approach will not suffice. We have to go further and devise and implement strategies to reverse diabetes. There are 3 ways by which diabetes can be reversed. One is bariatric surgery. We know it's very effective. It's a surgical field. I'll not dwell into the details. But many patients can achieve remission with bariatric surgery. Then we have the low-calorie diet and also carbohydrate restriction, about which we will see in the later slides. So the basic considerations need to be understood first. Physical activity is very important. We need to encourage our patients to do as much physical activity as possible, but the minimum should be at least 150 minutes of exercise, spread over at least 4 to 5 days a week. And the patient should target a 7 to 10% initial body weight loss according to the standard of care. And the macronutrient distribution is something like 45 percent from carbohydrates, around 30 to 40 from fat, and around 20% from proteins. But we will target a little further. We also know that higher fruits, vegetables, and legume consumption is associated with low risk of non-cardiovascular and total mortality. So having these things in mind, and given that we have various various dietary patterns, like the US dietary guidelines, the Mediterranean diet, the vegan diet, the low-fat diet, low-carb diet, very low-carb diet, DASH diet, paleo diet, that there are various diets. All of them are, the references about which are widely available. And they all actually help. But what we need to know is that there is a difference between therapeutic intervention and subtherapeutic intervention. In subtherapeutic intervention, when the patient is going to reduce only around, let's say, 8 pounds, the expected remission rate can be only around 7%. But in therapeutic interventions, when the patient can be expected to reduce around 20 pounds, the reversal of diabetes can be to the tune of nearly 50%. So that means it's not really important that we target weight loss and we achieve weight loss, but a substantial weight loss is required. And typically, Dr. Mike Lean had told that 10 kilogram or 10 to 15 kilogram of weight loss is what he considered ideal. But that was in the Western population. Maybe we can achieve the same results with a lesser value. We know that low-carb and Mediterranean diets have a lot of beneficial effects, both on carbohydrates as well as on the lipid profile. And to reduce carbs, the sugar consumption should be reduced. A low-carb diet typically will have less than 130 grams of sugar a day. And then we have the ketogenic diet, which have very less carbs, which means around 20 to 30 grams per day. And the rest come from protein and fat. Then again, the world started thinking aloud on the fat metabolism, which got revisited after the pioneering findings by Jason Fung, who published that in the Obesity Code. And he told that when we consume, like the conventional concept was that when we consume more energy and when the energy output is reduced, fat accumulates and fat stores are made. But that's not entirely true, is what he argued. And it is insulin which actually drives the increased energy or the remaining energy or the remaining glucose into the fat stores and increasing fat. So that means it is not only important that you have increased glucose intake or increased energy, but it's also important that there is increased insulin if there is going to be increased fat. So if either the energy is reduced or the insulin is reduced, or if both are reduced, then the fat stores will get depleted. So low insulin levels help. So low carbohydrate or low glucose will in turn produce low insulin. And that low insulin will deplete the fat stores. And the ketogenic milieu which is created will further decrease body weight, whereas the lean body weight is preserved. And the fat stores again get depleted. And that will improve the metabolic profile, the diabetic profile, to a big extent. So that can be achieved either with a low-carb, high-fat diet, which is known as the keto diet, or with intermittent fasting. There are a lot of plant-based and animal-based keto diet. And the summary of evidence say that there will be decreased body weight, triglyceride, and diastolic blood pressure. But however, there's a little concern that LDL cholesterol may get increased. The keto diet mainly intervenes through reducing appetite, reduction in lipogenesis, increasing lipolysis, greater efficiency in consuming fat, and increased metabolic cost of gluconeogenesis and thermic effect. But as I mentioned, there are also some potential adverse effects like negative effect, renal effects, rise in blood pressure, and impairments in the ability of insulin to reduce blood glucose, resulting in glucose intolerance. So we are not very sure. However, of late, it has been recognized that ketogenesis is an evolving method. It promotes breakdown of excess fat stores, sparing of lean muscles, and improve in insulin sensitivity, and probably may be worth considering under strict medical supervision. Now, fasting is a great technique. which, though being founded by our own father of nation, is grossly underutilized, especially in our country. There are different forms of fasting. It could be intermittent fasting, it could be calorie restriction, time restricted feeding, alternate day fasting, periodic fasting, and so on. Now, what we need to understand is fasting is very, very physiological, and all the organisms do have this phase of fasting. Even the prokaryotes, billions of years ago, have this this state when they do not feed. And there is something called a fasting physiology, which means certain things which happen in your body only during the fasting period. And this is important for repair and rejuvenation. And intermittent and periodic fasting may represent important factors in optimizing lifespan and health span. So if you have to live longer and if you have to live healthy, it is important that you also fast at times and not keep feeding, because the fasting mechanisms, especially the repair and rejuvenation, will happen only if you are fasting. And there are a lot of scientific mechanisms which have gone to explain how fasting actually improves not just our metabolic profile, not just taking care of various diseases including diabetes, but also improving the lifespan and health span. So intermittent fasting can induce beta cell neogenesis in experiments, and a plant-based diet or intermittent fasting or a modified fast several weeks, all are found to be effective. So having learned this much, let's start following some very practical tips and follow what is clear and evident. We all know that we are what we eat, and we need to eat judiciously. If we have to reduce our fat, if we have to deplete our fat stores and take care of the insulin resistance and various other deleterious effect of fat, then we should be targeting to eat around 20 calories per kilogram per day. And if we are going for more calories, then unfortunately, we cannot expect a weight loss. So the first mission would be to target less than 20 calories per kilogram per day. And this is very important. An Indian diet is very rich in carbohydrate, which is actually producing the whole lot of problems. So we should be targeting to consume less than 50% of carbohydrates a day. 20% can come from proteins and 30% from fat. This is, you know, very aptly put up in the Eat Lancet Commission global or planetary food plate, which is explained here. But it's a little cumbersome. Half the plate is fruits and vegetable. Of the other half, you have whole grains, starchy vegetables, dairy foods, animal products, animal proteins, plant proteins, then unsaturated fat, added sugars, and so on. And again, you know, the animal protein is further exemplified here. But actually, the very simple formula to follow would be the conventional food plate, whereby half the plate you fill with vegetables and fruits, especially low glycemic index fruits like apple, orange, pears, and guavas. And maybe you try to restrict the high calorie fruits. The quarter of the plate should be with proteins, maybe egg whites, sprouts, lean chicken, and so on. And vegetable protein is definitely better than animal protein. And if you are still not satisfied, maybe 1/4 of the plate you can have grains, and 10% of maybe dairy products if you are fond of dairy. But otherwise, if you avoid milk also, there is not much of an issue. So this is the bottom line: fill half your plate with vegetables, and that's IMA's national food policy as well. So a healthy, balanced diet means a lot of fruits, vegetables, whole grains, pulses, seafood, and nuts, and to have less red meat, processed meat, sugary food, drinks, and refined grains like white bread. So, ladies and gentlemen, let me again quote Dr. Roy Taylor. And let me read it out completely because I feel it's very, very important. Type 2 diabetes is a condition of having eaten more than required over a long period. And many of us are culprits. More fat than the individual's body can safely store has accumulated, leading to excess liver and pancreatic fat and subsequent loss of plasma glucose control. In the early years after diabetes onset, removal of the excess fat in these organs via intensive but achievable weight loss allows for many anomalization of hepatic glucose production and possible beta cell redifferentiation, and the condition can be reversed to normal. So isn't that a paradigm shift? And shouldn't all of us be attempting that? So to summarize, it's important to reverse obesity, even though it may be minimal obesity, and reverse diabetes. Good food is essential. Carbohydrates should be limited. The concepts of fat are changing. Remission of diabetes is possible. We have to move beyond standard care. And at any given of time, a given point of time, in the life history of a patient with diabetes, we should advocate intensive lifestyle intervention, especially focusing on good food. The earlier, the better. So it is with this intention that we started our lifestyle intervention program in our diabetes care center, and we would encourage all of you to start doing that. And I hope that this book, a book published by us, would guide you, especially your patients. It's a very simple book in Malayalam. You can tell your patients to have a look at it, and that will definitely help them to achieve remission. I thank all of you for your keen attention.